How soon can you land?
I can't tell.
You can tell me I'm a doctor.
No, I mean, I'm just not sure.
Well, can't you take a guess?
Well, not for another 2 hours.
You can't take a guess for another 2 hours?
How do you say the name of this place?
Yeah, no, we're not going to.
We're in the fish market.
We're at the fish market in Seoul.
Yeah, from South Korea. And we just bought, you guys just bought some crab.
We bought
some shrimp.
Crab and shrimp. It was like a kilo of crab, I think.
Yep.
Which is a pretty good sized king crab.
And it was 47,000 won.
47,000 won, which is about 45 bucks.
Yep.
So, and a kilo is, you know, 2 pounds. So it's like
$20 a pound.
Yeah.
Which isn't terrible.
No, I don't think so.
And now we're sitting in a small restaurant upstairs, and we're going to have it cooked for us.
Well, that's the theory. We just sort of sat down. The woman we bought it from gave it to a runner. He waved with us, held up 3 fingers, we nodded, and he walked upstairs, and we followed him.
Yeah. Took off our shoes, and now we sit at a small table next to a group of older gentlemen. And we're going to load up on some shochu.
We're definitely going to load up shochu. You're actually going to have shochu this morning?
I
was not entirely convinced of that. I'm excited to hear that.
I'm a bigger beer fan, but I'll have it.
They have beer.
I'll have the shochu. I haven't had any shochu this trip.
It's a little sweet. It's a nice bite.
It'll be good. A little bit of the chili paste with the meal.
So, yeah.
I'm not a big fish eater, but I came in here. So.
You're here, man.
So I'm going to see if I'm going to experience it.
You have a bite of the crab. It's good for you.
Yeah.
Exactly. You're not going to have like an anaphylaxis. Sorry.
We'll find out.
Do you have the EpiPen?
I have the EpiPen.
Good to go.
I can eat shrimp, so I'll be sure to do that.
Yeah. So for those of you wondering what's going on, welcome to Das Lines and Destinations, Gangnam Style. this is episode 68. We're going to release this one on Thanksgiving Day. So
what were you going to call it?
Gangnam Style.
But you said something about Turkey Day last night.
There was definitely gobbledygook.
Gobbledygook. Yeah. I like that one too. Gobbledygook and Gangnam Style.
Okay. Gobbledygook, Gangnam Style?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, put that all together. Welcome to episode 68 of Dots, Lines, and Destinations. This is Gobbledygook, Gangnam Style.
Yeah.
We are in Seoul, Korea. This is Steven and Seth. And we're a little bit of a mileage run, a little bit of, you know, just because it seemed like a good idea at the time, and hanging out, having some fun.
Yeah, we wanted to round out. I kind of wanted to round out the year with Miles. I think you were doing the same.
I need to hit my status also one last time. I keep saying one last time. It's always one more time. It's just a different status. But yeah, so we picked a nice little 3-night jaunt.
Which is longer than our usual ones.
Yeah, we've twice now commented, shit, are we supposed to be going to the airport already?
Which is tomorrow. I mean,
that will be tomorrow. Yeah, we'll be fine.
But last night, we went to the Lantern Festival.
Yep.
Near the City Hall area. Really cool, kind of in the canal. They had a bunch of lanterns floating, stilts they had put up, so it made it look like they were floating
down in the water.
Down in the water. It was really neat.
It wasn't how I would traditionally think of lanterns in the sort of like, in the Asian sense of like, you know, when I think of like the Chiang Mai Lantern Festival or something like that, where it's like little paper bags holding tea lights that manage to float because they're super light.
Yep.
And they glow, and or in India where they float them down the river, and you get this sort of effect. But this was
much more controlled, it seemed like.
Yeah, they were like decorated almost, you know, watercolor painted paper or fabrics of some sort that were lit from inside. So it was still very cool, but it was definitely different.
It was very busy. I mean, we didn't actually go down into
We couldn't get in.
Yeah, it was probably an hour and a half wait to get down into the canal. I think we had a better view from the top.
Yeah.
It was nice.
Certainly the part where we didn't get stuck walking in the crowd was better.
Yes. Had a nice Korean barbecue dinner.
Yeah.
And
lots of soju for that as well.
And before that, what was interesting was that we went and went to the Hanok Village.
Oh, you like the Hanok Village? It was cool.
You know, had the weather been much clearer, it would have been a very pretty view.
Yes, like the mountains around it. I agree. It is nice around a clear sky day. So the Hanok Village, for our listeners, is basically the old world, hundreds of years old version of Seoul.
Yep.
And it's as built. It's like this last little bastion of history, just tucked right in the dead center of the city. And it's, you know, all the old tile roofs and things like that. It's all buildings, one story or two stories at most, mostly. I wonder what that means.
Everybody out.
So it's a neat sort of environment in that regard.
It's very cool.
Yeah, I'm a fan. But it's also sort of this artist colony and very shops and things like that.
Little coffee shops, little artsy galleries. So it was very nice. I thought it was cool that we got to walk. I mean, there's a lot of people there, and it seems like it's a tourist attraction, even for Koreans. So
yeah.
It was neat to kind of mingle.
blend in with the tourists.
And a lot of selfies.
You're still jealous you don't have a selfie stick, aren't you?
No, I am not.
You sure?
I took a lot of pictures of people taking pictures with selfie sticks.
Because selfie sticks are everywhere here.
They are. Everywhere. 10,000 more.
No, I think I'm only 5,000.
Oh, really? That's cheap.
Yeah, it's a bargain, dude.
Maybe I should pick one of them.
Just in case. Yeah, so we did Hammock Village. We also did the Palace Grounds. I'm not even going to pretend to try to pronounce it.
Chittagong? Chittagong Palace?
Chittagong is a town in Bangladesh.
Oh, I'm way off.
It's like Gwangi Duck or something like that. Yeah, Chittagong is in Bangladesh. It's like an 8-hour flight from here. But yeah, it's cool palace grounds. That's, you know, sadly, lots of it has been burnt down and rebuilt, but it's basically 600-year-old grounds where the king used to live. And
which was ironic. The ironic part about the burning down is that they had water pits everywhere, water bowls everywhere to put out fires to get the palace still burned down.
We're going to go out on a limb and guess that perhaps there wasn't quite enough water in the bowls.
That's what I'm building.
Okay.
And when your entire palace built out of bamboo, wood, and lacquered up pretty good, it burns pretty quick.
But
it's been rebuilt really well. I mean, it's
very pretty. I mean, and some of it is the original. That, and the main gate is still the original, and so it's like, 600 years old. Very cool to see.
And what was interesting was the beauty of the different trees and the foliage around it was really nice.
Good time of year to be here. It's definitely fall. Lots of oranges and reds.
Yep.
More than the yellows. I think it's the type of tree we have here. It's like, I don't know. It gets to look like a maple in the States. I don't know if they are here. But.
And as we're saying this, we just watched two giant crabs that just came out of the kitchen go by.
You're getting a little hungry, aren't you?
It looks good.
You're excited about this. At some point, we should figure out what they did with our food. We have no idea.
It just disappeared. They took it. They looked inside the bag and kind of made a comment.
Did they say something?
Yeah, she just kind of went, and then they took it back there. So.
Okay, well, I'm sure that means they're going to cook it. Or serve it, or something.
Something.
But,
something will happen.
Something will happen. This is going to be good. I think we should take a pause in the episode now.
Yeah. We'll be back.
We're going to need to get some shochu in us, and we need to talk to a waitress and... I don't think our listeners want to hear us trying to fumble through that. I know I certainly don't. But we will pick this back up shortly with full mouths and pick up the crab claws.
Absolutely.
San Francisco Tower, United 1209 Heavy is the San Mateo Bridge, inbound 28 right.
United 1209 Heavy, San Francisco Tower, one call on runway 28 right, clear to land.
28 right, clear to land, United 1209 Heavy. United Tower, United 1209 Heavy is on the go.
Out of 1209, heavy flight heading 280, climb and maintain 3,000. Out of 1209, heavy flight heading 280, climb and maintain 3,000.
We're going to start climbing once the citation's out of sight. Thanks.
This is close enough. I'll speak in a loud voice.
Uh-oh.
So we're back.
Welcome back.
We had our nice little lunch.
Yes, for our listeners, you wouldn't notice that it's been like 2 hours since we were last talking. It's been about 8 seconds for you.
We're now back at the JW Marriott Dong Yimun Square.
I like how you mumbled right through the end of that. That's a different effect.
And we're back here recording. We're just going to talk a little bit about the news and maybe a little bit of our trip over.
Sure, it was a nice flight.
Yeah, you met us...
I met up with y'all in San Francisco. I came in from Houston and New Orleans the day before.
Yep.
Managed to get the 787 from Houston to San Francisco, which was, as always, a spectacular ride up front.
You had a little bit of a fun approach and kind of sort of landing in San Francisco?
We did land eventually. We had a missed approach. It's, I guess, the third time I know that that's happened for me.
Yeah.
Got down to about 1,000 feet and the clouds rolled in and we were doing parallel approach with, turns out, a private jet. And they waved both of us off because the visibility minimums dropped.
Yeah, I was actually watching your... Because I was wondering where you were because we were going to tell you where to meet us and stuff. And I looked on flight radar where your flight was and I actually watched the approach happen. And as it was happening, I look out the window and it just had turned... There's a cloud of gray falling over the field.
Yeah.
And sure enough, there goes your flight. You were down to probably 1,200 feet.
900, according to the map on the...
We were right back up in the air.
Yeah, it's funny. It's like I take, videos of lights and stuff. I'm like, this is going to be a great video. You're going to see a missed approach in action. And in reality, what you see is basically a gray cloud.
Yeah.
You don't see anything of, like, why was there a missed approach? What happened? All of a sudden, you just, like, the cloud's clear and we're not landed yet.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
So we couldn't see shit on the plane either, I guess is what I'm saying. So I'm no problems with the pilots doing a go-around. the part where then, like, the ground controllers routed us the wrong way to get to our gate, and it still took another 20 minutes to get in. A little nerve-wracking, because I was under the assumption that, you know, I was late for our connecting flight. Excuse me. Turns out not so much, because that was then, you know, 90 minutes delay. But
yeah, we actually took a delay, hour and a half. And we actually...
For United 747, that's vaguely on time, isn't it?
We actually got an old tulip bird, yeah.
That's true. One of the tulips.
And we made a mistake a little bit, kind of a traveler noob mistake. We ordered food before we went down to the gate at one of the restaurants, because we were hungry.
I don't think we made a mistake.
We got lucky we didn't miss the flight, I think.
Hey, they only paged us once. There's usually at least two final calls before they really mean it.
But we did get on the plane, and about 2 or 3 minutes later, the door did close. We were some of the last
Some of the last people on board, but that's, you know.
It was actually kind of nice, because we ate real quick, and by the time we taxied out, we were done with our food, had a glass of champagne.
Had the pre-departure beverage with the snack we bought in the airport, and then... You know, 2 hours later, by the time they finally got around to serving lunch, I was hungry again.
And it was actually a decent meal this time. We always talk about business class being not so great on United, but this was not amazing, but it was an edible meal.
Yeah.
And I got about 4 hours of total sleep, probably 3.5 to 4 hours of total sleep.
I think I did about the same. I staggered mine from yours, but
yep. Yeah. I kind of took a nap at the beginning and then took another short one near the end, and that was about it. And you took a nice one.
I took a nice mid-length nap.
Yep.
Basically tried to sleep from the equivalent of like 11 to 3 local time in Seoul.
Yeah.
So basically like, you know, from hour 6 to 9 or 10 of the 13-hour flight, 12-hour flight. Woke up, ate some more. Little disappointed we didn't have the soup. We had to have breakfast.
We can talk about why that happened a little bit.
There were shenanigans.
There were some shenanigans. They went from the back of the business class cabin to the front of the business class cabin, just taking orders as they went and filling those orders pretty much immediately. And we were in the first or second row of business class, so by the time they got to us, they were out of the soup.
Yep.
Which is what we wanted, because we didn't want breakfast. I mean, the plane gets into Seoul around 5 o'clock.
Right.
Normally.
6:15 if you're late.
6:15 for us. And so I really didn't want breakfast. I wanted a little bit of a heavier meal, a little more savory, dinner type meal.
I think it's, you know, it's a beef rib, short rib in a broth kind of thing with some cabbage and such. It's actually a nice meal. I had it last time I came over here, and it was very good.
Yep.
But, they definitely prioritized our meals orders for the main course, just not for the second flight, or the second meal. So, such is life.
Overall, good flight. Got into the airport. I mean, it was a nice mile-long walk to the immigration counters with the train ride and everything.
Yeah.
But immigration went fairly quickly,
mm-hmm.
and we were on the subway to the city.
Yeah, it was a quick ride in on the train. We were talking about this earlier. I still prefer that over the buses, as long as you're coming to something vaguely near the center of the city.
Yep.
Our hotel is 4 or 5 stops from Seoul Central Station. And, you know, if you're going down to Gangnam, if you're staying in Walker Hill, if you're going to one of those neighborhoods, I can understand taking the bus because it's more direct, but it's not necessarily faster. And the train was, you know, with the exception of a little bit of stairs on the connections, really not so bad.
Yeah, and where we're staying, actually, I would recommend to people. I think this is a good area on the one line, which is like central to what we've come to see, which was the Lantern Festival and where we were going today, the fish market. No transfers involved. It was kind of a straight shot.
Yeah.
So I like the area. I mean, it's walkable.
It's a great food market next door. We're going to go over there and have some snacks in a little bit, as soon as the fish market wears off.
Yeah, I think we should definitely post some pictures of the food that we get tonight and maybe give some descriptions and stuff. So, but I, you know, overall, I'm having a good trip. I wasn't expecting, you know, you try to fill your day up with stuff, and we've actually kind of paced it a little bit, and I like that. Taking it a little easy. I mean, I wouldn't say slow. We actually kind of took in the fish market pretty well. I think we walked it a little bit. We shopped a little bit. We kind of got sucked in by two little old ladies wanting us to buy their particular crabs. And that's what we did. And
Now, if you really wanted to have fun, it would be two little old ladies who wanted to make sure we got their crabs.
Yeah, I didn't want to go there, though.
No?
No, just trying to keep it, like, you know, PG-13.
That's still PG-13. Anyways, that's Seoul in a nutshell.
Would you come back?
I would. This is my second time here. I came and did a 12-hour layover once 5 years ago,
mm-hmm.
and actually did similar things. Did the fish market, did the Hanok Village, much better this time around. Partly because I wasn't quite as jet-lagged, and partly because we actually figured out how to, like, do the shopping and eat at the fish market. Last time I didn't figure that out.
Well, that's a good point. We didn't get jet-lagged, which is surprising. I slept really well the first night. You said you slept kind of mediocre the first night, but...
Well enough.
Yesterday, we had a full day and kind of wore ourselves out to the point we got back last night. We were out.
Yeah, slept a solid 8 to 10 hours again. Yeah. I mean, so I can't complain about that at all.
Absolutely, so...
But, yeah, it's been great so far. Would I come back? Yes. I would love to come back with my wife, show her some of the cool food stuff, some of the neat, like, the palace and the Hanok Village and stuff like that. I wouldn't spend a ton of time here.
Yep.
Just because I'm not really a city person. I mean, I am a city person, so I'm not a city traveler person. But that's definitely, if you like being in cities, there's definitely plenty of big buildings and, you know, that sort of stuff to see and do here, and the architecture and the museums and things like that that can... easily fill several days.
Yep,
so,
absolutely.
I would love to get down into the south, go to Busan, go to Jeju Island. You know, the fact that they fly like several 747s a day between here and Jeju Island is entertaining to me.
Kind of cool.
The fact that there's like 6 low-cost carriers that also fly that route, and I could just sort of commute back and forth trying all the different flights is tempting. But I imagine that would get vetoed where I hear with my wife, but... minor details. Yeah, I would come back. I like Korea. Relatively easy. You know, the subway system is very easy to get around. Plenty of English
signage.
Very
well explained.
There's a ton of stations. We're staring at a map right here on the counter as we're helping our other friend find his way to a place to go. And it's like hundreds of stations. It's a crazy system.
Well marked
and easy to get around. Some longish transfers in some of the stations, but... they also do the same thing here that they do in Tokyo, which is the station exits are all numbered. Hong Kong does it too. So it's not just like leave the station. It's you know which exit you're trying to go out of.
Yeah, we met a friend for dinner last night, and we just told him which exit number to meet us at. And sure enough, there he pops out when we were standing out there waiting for him. I mean, it can't get much easier than that.
Yeah, I like that. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
So
let's cover a little bit of the news.
Yeah.
United and Copa having a little breakup as far as reward programs and frequent flyer programs.
Can't say I'm too surprised.
Yep.
I would have expected it to happen sooner. I think there was a contract actually in place that prevented it from happening sooner. It's, you know, as someone who has flown Copa and gotten upgrades, obviously disappointing, but it makes sense to me that they would want to run their own program. They used to basically be... essentially a Continental subsidiary. Not quite, but Continental owned a big chunk of them, and the company operated basically as Continental Panama in many ways, from the livery to the aircraft to the service levels to...
To the clubs.
I mean, everything was sort of tied together. And, you know, the divestiture finished, I think, in 2008.
Yep.
Continental sold off the last of their shares, basically to keep their pension alive. Which is an interesting, you know, today, the way that all played out with the bankruptcy and the merger with United, how that, not United, Continental's bankruptcy, but because of United's bankruptcy, then merger, bit how the pensions all sort of played out, and they don't really apply the same way as they would have. So I wonder if, in retrospect, Continental management would regret that decision to sell off. Just the value of it has gone up tremendously.
Yep.
But anyway, there. So that partnership's done, and now... you know, they haven't announced if the clubs are going to become separate. I would imagine they will.
And part of the announcement was upgrade reciprocity, which has been a normal thing, is going to go away, as well as the 4-segment minimum for United.
And million-miler credits. Flights on Copa no longer count.
So there are some downsides for people.
And that takes effect. The weird part is it takes effect July of 2015.
Okay, so we still have
6 months,
yeah.
But it's also that it's mid-year is a little weird as opposed to happening at the beginning, you know, end of a year. But that's the way the timing works. So
I mean, in part of these announcements, I mean, this there was a bunch of announcements that happened last Wednesday, I guess, Tuesday or Wednesday.
Something like that.
Where United announced some changes to the Mileage Plus, specifically copays for PS flights, which are the transcons.
Right, for elites now have a copay where they didn't before.
And bag rules for golds, star golds, or golds on United.
Golds on United get one fewer free bag on domestic flights,
Domestic flights, yep. And no more inherited status when redeeming award miles. So this was a bug. I don't know if it actually was a bug. I have different feelings on this. But there was a bug... air quotes, that allowed redemption of Miles to actually make the person that was actually flying the ticket inherit the status of the person whose miles it came from, the account they came
right.
from.
Right. So if I, as a 1K, redeemed for someone who had no status, they showed up in the system as though they were a 1K.
Yep.
Let them get Economy Plus seats for free, let them get the higher bag allowances, things like that.
Yep.
Bug is a tough term to decide on. I'm certain that it wasn't originally the way they designed the system on purpose.
Yep.
I think it's just like no one ever thought about how that would happen with redeeming for someone else. And so when they built the system, you know, however long ago. So,
well, I wonder how this works too, because like we have the card that allows for upgrades on tickets.
Right.
If I buy a domestic
award seat, you get the credit card, gets you an upgrade.
Yeah, you get an upgrade.
Or get you eligible. If there's eligible.
So now that eligibility will drop to the bottom of the list, I would suspect, if the person you're redeeming for has no status. Which is disappointing.
Well, that benefit was never supposed to apply to people you're buying tickets for anyways.
But what if they have the card?
If they also have the card?
Yeah. Like, my wife has a card.
I don't know how that rule is supposed to apply.
You see what I'm saying? I mean,
yeah.
You get complicated with all these things, so...
Well, that benefit never works anywhere. Yeah, it rarely works.
Yes.
That I wouldn't even count on it.
There's some downsides for folks. The co-pays for the PS flights on using your mileage for upgrade is kind of a kick in the gut. I mean, it was a nice feature for elites not have to pay that.
It was. That at the same time, right, that's the one flight that requires an RPU instead of complimentary. I can see them trying to say, for the premium tickets, this is the way we do it, or the premium seats, this is how we have these rules.
Yep.
And for non-premium seats, it's different. And so from that perspective, I actually think it makes more sense. I don't like it.
Yep.
But sort of coming with the premium gets one set of rules, less premium gets a different set of rules, it does make sense to me.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm sure if they had just changed it when they introduced the copays and everything, if they had made that change then, I would have hated it then too. But
now it's kind of separate and it's gotten more attention, I think.
I think that's the real key, is that by not doing it first and now doing it, making that change, it did bring more attention to it.
Yep. Chase.
Ultimate Rewards.
Yeah, in Korean.
Have we figured out why they broke up?
I'm not sure. I mean, this has been hypothesized on a few sites, but I don't think anyone really knows what's going on, whether it's intentional or if it's just, you know, whatever reason it got taken off the site temporarily. What do you think?
I'm really glad that the other day when we were trying to find a random flight from Busan to Seoul that we didn't actually try to book using our Korean Air points via Chase, because I would have been really frustrated.
Yeah.
You never want to see a program where you have points lose a partner. You certainly don't like seeing that happen without any advance notice or warning and opportunity to sort of finish out.
Yep.
At the same time, and Korean Air has a nice-ish first-class product that you can redeem with basically only using their points. So Chase to Korean for first-class SkyTeam Awards was a nice thing to do. And decent coverage, and I think actually decent availability,
yep.
Even on the long stuff out of New York. So in that sense, sucks. To me personally, never used it, probably never was gonna.
Yep.
I mean, you don't even have a Chase Ultimate Rewards card, do you?
No.
So you must be really upset by this.
I'm torn. Just distraught. As you can hear in my voice.
Minor details.
But on a flip side, United has announced in a deal with OTG, which is a, what would you call them?
They run restaurants. Hospitality company, basically. But they run restaurants at airports.
Yes. They have announced a deal with them and a partnership with them at Newark, where you as a traveler can redeem miles for food and beverage options using kiosks, at the restaurant, give them your Mileage Plus number. And what do you think?
So the way it works is OTG has done this in a few different airports. So if you've flown out of JFK T5, the JetBlue terminal, you've seen this using their iPad systems. Delta at LaGuardia has it. Delta, I think, in Minneapolis has it. There's a few airports that have this service set up. I think it's actually in Toronto in one of the terminals also. And rather than placing your order with, you know, a waiter or a waitress, you sit down, you punch in. You have to tell it what your flight is. And you obviously don't have to tell the truth, but you tell it what your flight is because it reminds you before the scheduled departure that, like, there's 10 minutes until you need to go for boarding. Would you like a cup of coffee before you leave? Little things like that. But you log in and you basically place your order directly with the kiosk
on the iPad rather than telling a wait person what you want.
Yep.
And then they've all got a MagStripe reader, you know, sort of attached onto the side, and you can either swipe a credit card to pay, or, and this is the part that's new for United's, there's actually the opportunity to say, I'd rather pay with points. And you get presented with the total dollar amount or the total points amount. And the demo screen that United has shown, and I will preface what I'm, you know, this details by saying I'm not certain that it's the final numbers or the final ratio or whatever, was about 0.7 cents per point, which is not a great redemption ratio at all.
Yep.
You know, gift cards are usually a penny a point, so this is 30% worse than that. But it's real-time fulfillment, and, you know, if you have a small orphaned population of points, that's actually, you know, a way you can use them.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny, like, they show the example in the screenshot is, like, 700 points for a glass of orange juice, which seems preposterous. The fact that it's a $5 glass of orange juice, well, is also preposterous, so... Part, you know, getting upset that it's 700 points is one thing, but, you know, should we be upset to begin that it's $5 to begin with, not that it was 700 points?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's sort of one of the examples a bunch of people have latched on to and sort of railing on this. Part of me says this is, you know, taking advantage of those who are uninformed and don't know that they should get better value for their points. At the same time, at the conference I was at last week, was sort of listening, and one of the guys from United spoke and mentioned this program as part of, you know, their approach to providing value to their customers and multiple redemption options and avenues. And what was really interesting to me is one of the things he said was, so there's a couple things that are really interesting. One of the things he said was the people who fly the most, they're true high-frequent traveler road warriors, often don't want to get back on a plane and actually prefer to have other options for redemption. And they've shown that through, you know, their stats say that basically by looking at where people are redeeming their points, they see those passengers doing a lot less flight redemption and a lot more other odd item redemption.
Yep.
So, I mean, we've talked about this before in various times. I know you definitely, and I aren't necessarily that case, but you've got coworkers that absolutely feel that way.
Yeah, I mean, they're just, they don't want to be on a plane anymore. I mean, they're on a plane every week. The last thing they want to do as a vacation is take a plane ride somewhere.
Yeah.
And, you know, can probably deal with kids on a plane or whatever it is they're doing. They, you know, to them, it's not an attractive vacation.
So having this other out is nice. Even if it is at this theoretically horrible
at a valuation. Horrible rate. Yeah. I mean, they may do it.
Yeah. So that was one of the things I found interesting from what the guy said. The other part that was interesting to me was sort of talking about, is this... You know, is assigning essentially a cash value to points a way to convert them into sort of low-level earn and burn where people, you know, earn a couple hundred points, cash out, and move on, right? So instead of being focused on loyalty and trying to build a balance, which obviously the airline wants you to earn a whole bunch, then redeem, and earn a whole bunch, and then redeem, because there's a sort of sense of loyalty, a sense of more sticky business going on there. And the guys from United's comment during the show was essentially, actually what we found is it doesn't matter what they redeem for, as long as someone finds a reason to redeem with your program, they're going to want to earn more points in your program more quickly. So even the person who redeems the 10,000 points for $100restaurant.com gift card, which I can't imagine, but plenty of people do it, that person actually seems to come back and earn points again more quickly because it turns out that gift card is what they wanted.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that we often lose sight of just because things like a 3-day weekend in Seoul seemed like a good idea to us so much that, you know, we actually did it.
Yeah.
And hell, I'm doing it one way in coach. not entirely sure that part was a good idea, but whatever. But, you know, we think that more travel and going and exploring crazy places or even normal places is a really good idea. Not everybody really wants to do that all the time.
Yeah, I mean, there's some people who they see the points game at kind of like they see the, you know, other points type programs where, you know, like a grocery store.
Sure.
You know, they see, oh, I'm going to game the system. I'm going to get free fuel.
Yeah.
Right? But this is great. I'm going to shop at Randall's or Kroger or ShopRite or whatever it is that you're shopping at. I'm going to get free gasoline. Or a discount on gasoline.
Is that a thing?
That's a thing.
Hmm.
So
I guess you need to own a car for that to matter, right?
Yeah, probably. Okay. It would help. Unless you're like filling up the, you know, lawnmower, which I don't think you have one of those either.
I do not have a lawnmower. That's true.
You need a lawn for that.
I would need a lawn for that.
So...
And I guess a car to drive to the gas station to pick up the fuel for the lawnmower?
Preferably a car, you know, that's you wouldn't slosh the gas around in, so maybe a truck.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah, you people with, like, who live outside of the big cities have weird lives.
It's weird. It's weird out there in the suburbs.
Crazy, man. Anyway, sorry. Where were we?
So I think there is this market of people who aren't like us. You know, we are the odd ducks, I think.
Or, yeah.
And I say odd ducks, so we are the fringe of the programs because we are looking for the best redemption. We are looking for the best earn for the value.
You know, I'm not entirely sure I can agree with that. I think I mostly do.
Yeah.
But best is a very personal thing.
It is. We just basically established
that. Best is a very personal thing. So is travel the best redemption? To me, yes. To you, it seems generally yes.
Yeah.
I don't want to put words in your mouth. But
yeah, for the most part.
But that's not necessarily the case for everyone. Is that the best value? It's maybe the highest value in a sort of dollars to whatever ratio. And then you get into the debate of retail price versus what you would have paid for it, et cetera. Yeah. But, you know, I do agree. We are different. We are... Not even necessarily fringe, but we're definitely a different group, right? If you have all the silos of the different types of people that exist in all these programs.
Well,
like ours is a smaller group.
Yeah.
And it's, you know.
To give you an example, I mean, I know some people who value their points for travel, but they don't have points with airlines necessarily. They have membership rewards points or something.
Okay.
And they will just go buy a business class ticket on BA.
And redeem the points.
Pay
for points kind of thing?
Yeah. And they value that because I needed a last-minute ticket or semi-last-minute ticket to London for a short vacation or, you know, maybe a long vacation. I had this planned out for months, and I'm going to splurge.
Sure.
I see people do that, but I see them a lot more of the time do things like, I'm going to use my membership rewards for a gift card, or I'm going to use my membership rewards for a car rental.
Yeah.
Because it's what they value. I mean, you know,
My parents went to Italy recently and stayed at a lovely hotel, and it was not part of a program, not part of a chain, and my dad has entirely too many Amex points from over the years. He's like, yeah, screw it, I'm paying with points.
Yeah.
That's how I want. And Amex membership rewards as a hotel redemption has always been a bad value, but that's how he got the best value out of him that day.
Yeah, he said, I'm not going to spend the money.
Right.
I've got these points. They're sitting around. And that's how we're here. We should state that. I mean, that's how we're at the JW Marriott. We're in a massive suite.
That's true.
There's three of us. I had actually made this booking on points. I had 115,000 Marriott points. And it was $35,000 a night here. And I said to myself, what else am I going to use these for? They're going to go bad. You know, they're going to expire at some point. Let's have fun with this and not pay for the hotel room.
Thank you.
Yeah, and it ended up being a good thing. We got an upgrade. And it worked out well. We've had a good breakfast in the morning before we go out for the day. And so for me, the value was right now. It wasn't of I'm gonna make plans for some vacation I may never take. It's, hey, I've got a vacation coming up that I can use these points on, and that's where I get the value from them.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I play that both ways a little bit, right? Like I'm working on a trip to Japan and possibly Germany at the same time and trying to make points work for that because that's going to be an out-of-pocket trip and I want to do it. But, you know, 2 years ago when I started earning the points that will eventually pay for that trip, I didn't know that either of those things were going to be the trip. I sort of figured there'd be some trip in the future that I'd want to do it for. And I guess that speaks to your point more than I thought it did, which is... See how I tried to correct you and I was wrong? It doesn't happen very often, I don't think. But it was, you know... I knew I was going to want to travel, and so...
You didn't know how or when.
But I didn't know how or when or where. Yeah. So it wasn't like, okay, in 2016, me and my wife are going to go to Iceland, and so now I need to figure out how to get the right points to make Iceland work.
Yep.
That was never sort of... That's never been my approach to this. I've looked at them as sort of accumulate enough, and then when the time comes to do anything, figure out how to use some of the ones I have.
Yep.
And... I'll go out again and say that makes us a little different.
Yeah, it does. Absolutely.
So.
Well, I think we can wrap up that topic.
Yeah.
Delta and Airbus signed a contract for a bunch of new planes.
50.
Yeah,
50 new wide bodies.
A mix of A330neos.
Yep.
And A350s.
Yes.
Do we know which version of the A350s?
The 900 series.
The 900, okay.
So the smaller of them.
Yep.
The A350-900s are for Trans-Pacific, Delta said, although some of the A330s can do Trans-Pacific also out of Seattle.
Okay.
And, or the shorter Pacific routes. I don't know if that also includes some Detroit routes. But,
yep.
And then the 330s will mostly be replacing the transatlantic 763s.
Gotcha.
So, yeah, and the 350s are replacing the 744s and some, I guess, adding a little bit of growth to the market because there's only 12 744s left and they bought 25 350-9s.
I wonder if they're going to replace, because they have a couple of 763s that they use out of
Pacific also.
Yeah, out of the Pacific to Portland and the Seattle for a couple of the the Pacific routes. I'm guessing they're probably going to replace those.
Yeah, I mean, the 763s were ready to go. It's interesting to me, Delta's, you know, the numbers they're saying is basically 20% fuel savings across, operating cost savings across the board, which is significant, but doesn't seem quite as high to me as I would have expected for, like, from an old 763 to the newest re-engined planes. I actually think, I don't know, maybe I'm completely off base, but that number, the 20% number seemed a little low to me.
Do you think they're promising low and hoping to hit high with savings and make it
even better?
Yeah.
Go in with reasonable expectations? I don't know. And maybe it's just that that's what the numbers are. I mean, 20% is a big change.
Yeah, that's a big change.
But it's... the other part of that that's interesting to me is that, A, Delta has had 787... orders on the books for a long time
from Northwest. Yep.
And they deferred them once, and now it seems like, you know, they came back, they deferred them out to like 2022 or something like that. And they want these planes in 2017, 2018. And Boeing apparently could not get them back in the production cycle quickly enough.
Yep.
Whereas Airbus could, and that has been reported as part of the reason Airbus won the order. And Delta even tried to give them some 777s and Boeing tried to give Delta some 777s, and Delta was like, nah, it's like a stopgap. And Delta was like, yeah, we kind of just want the planes we need. So it's an interesting aspect to how this works. Boeing can be as upset as they want about losing the deal, but at some level, it's like, well, we lost the deal because we're making these planes for other people as fast as we can.
Yeah. So
it's an interesting problem to have.
They have two production lines that are stretched to their capacity.
To be fair, they still haven't actually hit the delivery rates that they really thought they'd be at right yet.
Yeah.
So part of it is their fault, right? Right. They're full because they're not delivering fast enough.
Things are slow, definitely.
But that'll be fun. I think when the 330neo was announced, we may have talked about this on the show, talking about, I was betting that Delta would try to pick up some of the last classic engine option planes because they seem to not mind picking up a cheaper plane with a slightly higher operating costs. In this case, I'm guessing Airbus was like, no, we're not doing that. Like, we can switch anytime we want. We don't have to unload classics because it's more or less the same plane with new engines on it.
Yep.
So they didn't have to, you know, deliver the old engines they had backstocked or anything like that.
And we kind of know what the interior of the A350 is going to be, at least in coach. I mean, it's only two products, right?
Yep.
So it's...
No, there's four.
Oh, there's four, okay.
There's four seats in the Airbus book.
Gotcha.
But you have, for coach, you have to buy from their, the catalog. And it's a couple of Recaros and BE Aerospace, I think.
Yeah.
So there might be a Zodiac, I'm not sure.
I mean,
and that could change over time, but there's very few choices. It's not going to be, well, I say we know. The one thing we don't know is it going to be 9 or 10 abreast.
Yeah. It's very good point.
10 is always an option.
Yep.
None of us want it.
But
Boeing has said it, or Airbus has said it could work.
Yeah.
So could be interesting.
Well, you think we wrap it up for right now and then come back a little later from some of the food stalls?
Yeah, I think it's time to go get some snacks.
Let's do it.
All right. Talk to you soon. Welcome back once again. This is, we'll call it part three, although who really knows at this point, of Dots, Lights, and Destinations, episode 68, recording on location in Seoul. Stephen and I are now sitting on a stoop in front of the Dongdaemun Gate.
Yep.
Literally in the shadow of the 600-some-odd-year-old entrance to the city of Seoul.
Yep.
And
We finally got Stephen to eat some street food.
Yeah, had some dumpling from a little lady down the street, and that was good. It was good. Yeah. She wrapped it all up New York style with some rubber bands and styrofoam, but brought it over here. I enjoyed it. I think we're going to go and get some Korean barbecue later, bibimbap or something, but it was a nice little hold-me-over snack for the evening, and we got to walk around and see some back alleys of the shopping area here.
I think that was actually probably the interesting part. I mean, it's dark out. It's become dark since we were last talking to everybody, and we walked down some pretty dark alleys. There was not a lot of light down some of those areas.
And we were the only people on them.
I mean, it didn't feel dangerous.
No.
Is that because we're idiots?
I think it's just, it was quiet, you know.
Because it's a Sunday?
Things feel
Tuesday. Tuesday nights would have been worse?
Yeah, Tuesday nights, you know, people are out.
Details.
Watching for us, so.
Yeah, no, I really have, you know.
I feel safe here.
Yeah, completely. So that's been nice. But a little bit of fun, a little bit of out and about. I think we've got to visit a good feel for the vibe of the neighborhood.
Yeah.
I really feel like. I mean, some of the markets and, you know, even just some of those back alleys, the ones that were slightly less quiet, was like, was a section of just like toy stores and a section of electronic stores and a section of fish tanks and stuff. Like,
it's definitely an interesting neighborhood. You know, you got the Hanook's not that far from here, the gate and the wall right here that we're sitting under. It's interesting, and you've got the traffic, you've got, you know, it kind of feels like a little like New York. You've got traffic going by, people honking, people merging, motorcycles weaving in and out of people, and it's interesting.
I'll give you all that other than the honking. I haven't really heard a ton.
Every now and then you'll hear a cat.
Every now and then, but like, we've been sitting out here for probably 20 minutes we've been recording now. Okay, fine. Someone finally honked to prove me wrong. Just saying, there isn't a lot of it.
No, it's very light. You notice
that?
It's very, like, quick.
Yeah. It's definitely not. That's definitely not New York style.
No, it's not that. You know, so.
Why not? Yeah, and I'm digging Seoul.
Yeah.
I'm really enjoying
it.
It's
fun. What is it? South Korea's got Seoul? Is that the saying on the shirt?
Really?
There's a shirt that says that.
Yeah. Who wears such shirts?
I have no idea. I just saw it.
Where?
I don't know. I don't remember where.
Okay.
I just know I've seen it.
We'll give it to you then. Don't get me wrong, I use that phrase all the time, but in a very puntastical sort of way.
I think that's what the shirt's in.
Okay.
I enjoyed it here. This was fun. Good trip. It's all some new culture, new experiences, and I'll come back.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to hold you to that.
Yeah, absolutely. Do that.
Or something like that. Because, you know, I really care that much. Awesome. Well, I think as you mentioned, it's time to actually go get some real food now, because, you know, we've only had 3.5 meals so far today, and I try to make it to 5 on any good trip.
Yeah, so. We've done nearly 3 miles today, so 3 or 4 miles today.
That's it?
Of walking. Yeah, it's a little less than yesterday.
A little less.
But I need to get my carbs back up. My caloric intake needs to go up.
And to justify the walking, or to steal yourself for sitting on a plane all day tomorrow?
Exactly. I've got to fatten up just in case I don't like the food that's offered.
Yeah. At least you're going to be in business class.
That's true.
I'm doing it in coach. I have to fatten up because there might not be food. You
might want to grab some dumplings for the road.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they don't keep well enough for that door. But I actually kind of wish we had gotten some of that chili sauce for the road.
Yeah, that was damn good at lunch. That was really good.
It's like sesame oil or fish oil, and then chili sauce and scallions.
Scallions. I really like the scallions in it. It's really good.
Yeah. I'd love to figure out how they call that and what it is, and find a jar of it somewhere in duty free or something.
Yeah.
And then see what happens when customs asks me what I bring in home.
What is it, sir?
I don't know.
Red.
It's red, so it's probably spicy. I don't know. That's a couple more horns. Alrighty, well, I think we're going to pull the plug on this one and wrap it up. If you're looking for our absent members, you can find Foz on Twitter at FozM, or at he blogs occasionally at upgrd.com/Foz. Rolo is at MundoSurfer on Twitter, and he is mundosurfer.tumblr.com. And I am Seth, the Wandering Airman. I'm at WANDRME, or put a period in that if you're looking for a web address.
Yep. I'm Stephen Seagraves. You can find me at badice.com, at FCGraves on Twitter. And you can follow the podcast at
Dots Lines
or online moredotsmorelines.com. And leave a comment. Facebook, I think we have a Facebook
page. Yeah, we got a Facebook page. We don't really use it for anything.
Yeah. So leave us a comment, send us an email. I'd love to hear from you. Maybe you've been to Seoul and have some suggestions that we missed.
Yeah. And Jamie, you're welcome. Take care.